Okay. Welcome everyone. We're going to talk about our experiences using microservices at 20. Okay, so why microservices? I can guess what you are probably thinking when you hear that this word. Some months ago, our ex-colleague Pedro Gómez was in the CraftConf, and he came to a moment when he had listened so many times the word microservices that he wrote this very polite tweet. Okay, it's in Spanish, sorry, but he's saying basically that he was a bit tired of listening about microservices. He was so sick of hearing about microservices that he proposed this game. We have it in English this time. Thank you, Batman. Microservices, microservice, the word, we drink a shot. Oh, perfect. This is our class, obviously. You have our tweet account if you want to insult us publicly or whatever. And we start microservices.
Cheers.
Cheers. Much better. Okay. later. Okay, so the important thing here is that we both work at 20. And okay, we're going to talk first. How was our situation like 1 year and a half ago when we started thinking on moving to a microservices architecture? First of all, yeah, I said it. Oh, sorry. 20. This is what most people still think 20 is. Some years ago, 20 was a very popular social network, mainly used by teenagers. Okay, at least. But these teenagers grew up. Well, some of them grew up, and it the use of the social network dropped a lot. So the company changed completely its focus, its market, and 20 is now a mobile operator. It was a big change. And all this is important because then we have all our code, mainly PHP code, was in the same source repository, a social network and a mobile operator with not so many things in common, really. So the repository was like a PHP monolith. It was very huge and difficult to manage, as you can guess. Also, PHP is not probably the best language for big projects, big long-term projects. So we wanted to change that. We had also this problem. Every time we wanted to deploy a new version, to do a release, it wasn't as fast as we wanted. We did a big effort to make it more agile, but like as the code was so huge, you had to integrate every change you did. You had to integrate with changes of a lot of people who is working at the same time in the same code base. So you have conflicts, you have to restart the game once and another. Okay, so it was slow. And the tests, the integration tests, were also took many time to run, so it wasn't really really fast. Okay, so we decided to move into a services architecture. And okay, first we saw what choices we had to implement them. That's later. Sorry. No, first of all, some generics about microservices. Maybe you have heard this in another talk, or maybe tomorrow, or I don't know, but okay. Microservices are independent components which have its own database, have its own source repository, and are independently deployable. They have well-defined interfaces, and they communicate with a simple communication layer, typically HTTP, but not very difficult. And okay, sorry. yes, really, more or less, this is SOA. It has a lot of years. You now call them microservices, but more or less this is SOA. The only difference really is that now in microservices are supposed to have a simple communication interface, while typical SOA have like a communication bus and things more complicated. But I'm not sure that this point only is important enough to deserve a new name like microservices. But okay, I don't care really. one advantage of the microservices, microservices architecture is this: we can mix technologies, we can have use different languages, and we can use the right tool for the right job. Apart from that, we can also have with the same language, we can use different platform versions to test new features or whatever, and do incremental technology changes more easily. Okay, many people also say that this is an advantage of the services, and is that if you have a distributed architecture, it forces to have separation of responsibilities. You have some systems with facades with interfaces well defined, different source repositories. Oh, okay, that's good, but you don't really need microservices for this. It's stupid. You can just use libraries, jars, and have their own repository for everyone and deploy everything together in a monolith. That's not a big deal, really. Okay, this really is I think, an important advantage of microservices. And when you read the Agile Manifesto, it talks about continuous delivery and about self-organizing teams. If we tie this together, and we have that every service has one team responsible of it, and we have that the teams are responsible of their deployments, then we can achieve something better than continuous delivery. It's continuous deployment. Every time we make a change in a service, we do a new feature, or we fix a bug or whatever, and we complete it, pass the code review, test, etc. We deploy it instantly. I program that and I deploy it in the moment. It's really great, this. But okay, this is very good, but they are not good for everything really. They have high costs. They don't have transactions. For example, you have a distributed architecture. Okay, there are distributed transactions which we could use, but at the end they are difficult to make it right, make it work right, and they have a cost in latency and in performance. And at the end, I think they are rarely used in microservices architectures, I mean distributed architectures in general, because according to the CAP theorem, you have to sacrifice one between consistency, availability in a distributed environment, between consistency, availability, and partition tolerance. And usually, what you sacrifice in distributed environments is consistency to have better performance. Okay, apart from that, microservices require a much more complex infrastructure. We are we are hearing today a lot of talks about Kubernetes, Fabricate, etc. All this is going for this point to make it simpler, but it's still much more difficult than a single web. And they are more difficult to do integration testing because with all the services running, because it's more difficult in general. It's obvious. What else for us? It seemed like a good idea, and taking into account these advantages and disadvantages, because 20 is organized in small teams, small independent teams, self-organized. So we really do this continuous deployment I said before. As I said, because we have PHP, but we wanted to use Java. We have a strong SRE DevOps team. And besides, our software was going to use third parties. So transactions weren't possible anyway. So this architecture was great for us. Okay, the first, when you are doing a distributed environment, maybe the first point to decide is the communication protocol. How are going the services to communicate one to each other? These were the libraries that exist for this. There are a lot, but mainly for problems with PHP, we really only have one option. Well, one great option is really good, but it's Swift here at the end. It's a good option, but we didn't really love it so much because it generated a lot of PHP boilerplate. And anyway, we had a communications layer between PHP components, so we could adapt that to Java, and it wasn't so costly. So we did our own structure layer. We called it the service. It's RPC based. It's very simple, really. At the end, we just did an implementation of JSON RPC, so very simple. And the interfaces are defined with an IDL file. And from this IDL, we generate Java, PHP, and even Erlang clients, interchange objects, and server stuffs. This is an IDL file. It's very simple. You have the interface with the operations, the interchange objects, and it's Java. Really, it's a subset of Java. It's really simple. The important thing here, comparing to other systems like Swift or like protocol buffers, is that these files have a version. And every version has its own complete file. If I want to create a version 2 from this, I copy it totally. I generate again the objects, and they are different classes. And in other systems, they use like identifiers for the parameters or things like that. Versioning is important for these interfaces, and I'll show you why. Because let's suppose we have a service with a version 1. We have two clients using it. We can change it without the need to create a new version if we just add new methods or new fields in objects. But if we want to add new parameters in some method, or we want to delete methods or delete parameters or fields, then we have to create a new version, version 2. And the most important thing here is that we deploy them together, version 1 and version 2. So when we deploy the new version, version 2, the clients which are using version 1 still work. We don't have to restart any service, or we don't have a service outage, or nothing. And when a client is updated to use the version 2, it still works. Okay, now I'm going to talk a bit about the Java platform we need to make easier the developments. And so, yeah. Our Java platform is really very simple. It isn't complicated at all. Our technology stack doesn't have anything strange or complicated. It's basically used for dependency injection, Hibernate to access MySQL databases, other common libraries like log4j or Quarth, and other libraries to access external systems like Memcache or Hadoop. And we developed some common features on this platform. First of all, this is important. If you have a distributed architecture, you need to have a common configuration, a shared configuration repository. In our case, we called it xconfig, and it's based on some YAML files, in a Git repository. So when I make a change in some config file, I call it, I push the change, and the services are designed so that they automatically hot reload the change and adapt, and we don't have to restart anything. Everything, even the database pools, everything hot reloads. So you don't have to restart the server because of a config change. And we also have an overriding system by environment, by common configuration or by service, etc. We also added this feature, the possibility to create asynchronous jobs easily with a queue and a thread pool, configurable thread pool. And also we can create by config cron jobs which run periodically and use the same asynchronous structure. We also have the possibility of activate or deactivate a feature by config, which is good if you do something that is risky, or if you have to wait until some other component, other service, or something in the environment isn't still ready for the change. And it also allows to activate incrementally a feature for some users or to do A/B tests. And finally, we also did JUnit runner, a custom JUnit runner for integration test, which bootstraps the platform and allows to inject mocks for the other services. And now Aaron is going to talk about monitoring. Bye.
I'm gonna talk to you about the monitoring processes and technologies that we use at Puentia. First of all, I would like to emphasize the importance of developing a good and strong monitoring culture, because it will help a lot preventing or detecting some problems that you might have. And what do I mean by developing a strong monitoring culture? I mean learning how to program taking into account that you need to know probably at any point what is happening or what has happened in your system. That is accomplished by having verbose and accessible logs, having plenty of metrics, even about things that you don't think you might need, and also alarms. Having a good monitoring ecosystem is even more important when working with distributed architectures, just because of their nature. You have more components and they interact one with each other, so it's more probable to have problems and you don't know where to look. Maybe some of you are thinking that you don't make mistakes, your code is perfect, so you don't need this. But believe me, shit happens, and you will like to have a good monitoring stuff. Okay, let's move into logs. We were looking for a library for Java in order to log, and we didn't break our head. We went simple, and we used Log4j. Log4j was simple enough, powerful enough, was simple, and we only needed to use some kind of extra features like filters and appenders in order to, for example, filters to customize the message that was or the data that was being logged. And then the appenders so we can store the data in different storages. This is an overview of the appender that we currently have. And as you can see, we, for example, call the info method from log4j, and we automatically log into MySQL, Logstash, and Hadoop. We need different storages because we use every one of them with different objectives. For example, MySQL. We use MySQL for doing complex queries in SQL, so we can detect when was calling one service to another, or what was the output of an specific call, or things like this. Logstash, we found Logstash later, and it's the main analyzing tool that we use currently. And then we have Hadoop. Hadoop is for long-term storage. Okay, I said before that we are using some filters to customize the information being logged. One of the things that we add to the information being logged is, as well, Andres told you about T-Service, that is the protocol that we are currently using. We generate some unique identifiers for every call and a global ID. I mean, when we start a new session, a new request for the first time, we generate a global ID that is kept along all the subcalls, and then for every call we have a unique identifier, so we can easily find which service spoke with which other, and the answer and times and all this. And about Logstash, I said that we use it currently for as main analyzing tool for logs, but in fact what we use is Kibana. Okay, Kibana looks like this. Probably you know it already. And you can change your query. You can customize the data being returned. And then you have like a graph with the logs on a timeline. So you can see the kind of logs being stored in the system, at what time, and by color the level. Then you have at the bottom all the log entries, and you can click on every one of them, so you get the full details being logged. Okay, now I'm gonna talk about metrics. We love graphs at 20, and we wanted to make it as easy as possible to add a new metric. We already had a working stack, StashD with Graphite on the PHP side, so we can use it. And things that we are tracking, well, as you can see, we added some metrics by default in the platform that we created, like the service calls or things like that, and also metrics coming from JMX, like CPU usage, number of threads, free threads, or whatever. And then there's also metrics related to business. As you can imagine, we use so many, we tested so many dashboards, and finally we start with the default Graphite one, that is a little ugly, but you get to love it, and Grafana. As you can see, it's a little ugly, but the hierarchy that you have on the left, is kind of a tree, is very useful, so you can see at a glance what metrics you do have. And as you can see, Grafana is prettier. and you can customize the layout. So you can actually create monitors and have them around the office. Cool. And one thing that I love from Grafana is this UI. If you find yourself in front of creating a query to Graphite, you have so many methods being called, so you end up with a parenthesis, another parenthesis, another parenthesis, and then you have some parameters that you don't know which is acting. It's really weird to write a correct query, and this is really helpful. You choose the metric and then apply some functions over the result in sequence. Okay, graphs are cool, but most of the time they are useless because you won't have somebody staring at them 24/7. So you need some kind of notification so you can know when something is wrong or at least weird enough to take a look. Okay, some things that we are currently monitoring as alarms are coming from different data sources, SQL queries, Graphite metrics, or HTTP requests. So we took all this and started looking for a framework so we can have alarms on a new platform, and we end up creating a new one, creating our own. So we could easily extend it and create multiple data sources. Also, we wanted to have a quick way to change the condition being evaluated for every alarm. And also, we wanted an observer system. So when an alarm rises, we get a notification. In the end, we end up using only MySQL and Graphite as data sources. And we created a condition evaluator based on Java expression language. You write in your config file your condition and it's evaluated. And also an email notification. And then later we found Cabot. If you don't know Cabot, you should. And you can create your alarm separated by services, so you can choose whatever service or create a new one, and this is the view for a service. As you can see, you have multiple integrations already, so you can have notifications sent through HipChat, an SMS or an email or whatever. You have an overview of the current status, and at the bottom you have the Graphite checks. You want to see a Graphite check, it looks like this. If you want to create a new one, you just set the Graphite metric, check the data is correct, and then you set the condition type and the value. Also, the importance is important. As a funny note, we use the critical one, so it wakes up people in the middle of the night. If an alarm rises and the importance level is critical, somebody wakes up. The benefits of using Cabot are, as you saw, obvious. It has a friendlier UI than config files that we have. We didn't have any dependency on the service being monitored because our framework worked inside the same service. So if the service went down, we didn't have alarms. And also Cabot is open source and is currently being developed. As a conclusion about alarms, where are we heading now? We are now trying to move all our Graphite alarms to Cabot instead of our own alarm framework. And we are trying to replace the fixed value threshold in favor of estimations, dynamic expectations. If you don't know, hot winters is an estimation function that takes the data from this week and the week before and estimates the expected range for the current value. Anyways, I have to say that currently the main alarms platform being used is the old one, the one that we created, and that's because Cabot is not polished enough yet. And that's all what monitoring. I will let Andres.
Monitoring. Monitoring is really important at the end because you you know when something is down. Okay, and now in this time we have learned some lessons. This is the most important. The domino effect. When you have an architecture of services, let's guess that a service, service one, for example, gets degraded, starts working slower and slower. Yeah. So this service two or service three or whatever, what is using it, when it calls it, it has to wait a long time until it gives an answer. So it gets degraded too. And the same is with the service we see using the other, the three, the four, five. After some minutes, everything is broken. Just because a service started going slower. This is really shit of a distributed architecture, but okay, it can be avoided. Basically you have to start thinking synchronously. Okay, so some solution. Basically, we don't get in a distributed architecture, we don't want to get blocked for too long. So, for example, for the concurrent requests, we don't want to wait for three threads. If all the threads are busy, just throw an error and that is. And so that it's better to have an error than to propagate the problem to all the system and everything get down, so throw an error and that is. We did our own rate limit mechanism because when the container doesn't have, if you limit the number of container threads and you reach the limit, it throws an HTTP error, and we prefer that the error is controlled and monitored and everything. We also have to tune the size of every blocking pool, the thread pool, the database pool, and whatever. And we also have to tune the timeouts, basically the types, especially the client's timeout, so that if you will call a service which is running slow, you have a limit of time waiting. We did this timeout so that it's configurable depending on who is calling, what is the service, the client service, what is the server service, the operation you are calling, on everything, because not all the calls are supposed to be equally fast. We also have problems with this, with the synchronous, with the logging in general. As Aaron said before, we are logging to several systems and we did it synchronously. So it was a problem really fast and when there was a peak or something, it started to work everything bad. So, okay. We're using Log4j. Log4j has now the possibility to be asynchronous. It has asynchronous logger, so we can wrap our logger with an asynchronous logger, and we have a queue, a read buffer, That's it. We store the message there and we forget and we return fast. But we had a problem also with this, because as they are implemented right now, when the ring buffer is full, you have to wait. No! Again, wait. And it's not configurable at all. So we have to also use asynchronous appenders, which have their own queues with their own pool of threads, etc. This worked well because when the queue with an asynchronous appender is full, you can configure it so that the messages are discarded, which is much better in this case. So this worked for us. In general, we're working on this. We're working on that our operations tend to be asynchronous in general, if they can. So for getter operations, which can be asynchronous, must be synchronous, we prefer speed over consistency. So we catch values, we use the old values if we don't have the current value we need, and if we see that our the value is very old or we don't have the value, we return and we order an asynchronous operation to update it. For setters, we make them asynchronous basically, and there is no operation result. The client just calls the operation. It doesn't know if it was well or there was an error. And then it can wait for a notification with the result of the operation, or it can query the status of the change, or query a list of ongoing operations, or a list of operation results. And we want to go to a publish subscribe model. Using persistent queues with retries with an event-driven model, following the principles of reactive programming. This is where we are going now. This is also something we are working on right now, and it's the circuit breaker. Circuit breaker is a pattern for distributed systems. The idea is that when the client service wants to call another service, it considers the status of that service. It can be based on previous recent calls. If you just before has made a call and it has been slow, you say, okay, this is degraded. Or you can call health checks over the service. Basically ask it, how are you? Are you fine? Family, etc. And if the client sees that the service is degraded, doesn't call it. It's what is called close the circuit. And then it can return a default response, or it can enqueue the operation for later retry, or just throw an error. It's always better to throw an error that to degrade all the system. So we are finishing now. We want to encourage you to try all this, to make your own services or whatever. It's really easy because there are many people working on this now. There are a lot of implementations of basically everything. For communications layer, you have, for example, Thrift or gRPC or Kappenproto, which are great. Or you can do something simple. You can do just a REST interface or JSON or something like that. For the services platform, you can use Spring Boot, DropWizard, Spark. There are a lot of options. Or you can also take a look at the Netflix stack, which is really great. It's very good. I think tomorrow there's a talk about this. And okay, it can be somewhat difficult. You take some of this and you put that everything together and okay, what can be wrong? So, thank you. Questions? We are right now. Okay. He's asking in the message. The message architecture we are looking now. What are we considering or what are we going to use? We don't have a decision yet. We are looking for some things. We probably will look at I don't know, ActiveMQ and things like that, and Fabricate, and all this, but but we don't have now a decision. Sorry. Surely we will end doing our own solution as always. But I don't know. More questions? Yes? Like 15 or so. No, more. We count the PHP.
Software.
I don't know, between 15, 20, something like that. Not many, really. More? Question? I haven't told us. Really, when we decided to move to microservices, it was because we were going to change everything, all the implementation, basically, because we were using the code to access Telefonica, and we were moving to use MVNE. So we had to change the implementation of the mobile operator. So we reused some PHP code in the form of PHP services, but it wasn't really much. I mean, basically, the login, the users, etc. Ah, sorry, the question, because some of you can haven't listened. He has asked if we reduced some code when we moved from a monolith to the services architecture. Okay. More questions? Okay. Thank you. If anyone wants a shot, it's water.